the world is not what it was meant to be. All this pain, all this suffering, there's a better place waiting for me in heaven. Every tear will be wiped away, every sorrow and
Good morning. We're going to ask you all to stand as we worship the one true living God. We're going to start with Come Now is the Time to Worship.
And there are a few things we want to make you aware of. First of all, we want to remind our women about the Extraordinary Women Conference that's in Tulsa. It'll be on March the 3rd and the 4th. You see the details there. Next Sunday morning, we are going to be observing the Lord's Supper. What a great time that will be for us to be here and be together and to remember what our Lord did for us. And then our men, we want to let you know about the prayer breakfast that we're going to have together. That is going to be the first Sunday next month, Sunday, February the 5th, and it'll be at 8 o'clock a.m. So it's good to see you. How many of you are glad to be here today? I'm glad, too, and I'm glad to see your faces. You look all ready to worship the Lord and lift up His name and spend time in His Word. This is going to be a great day. I believe it. How about you? Amen. Join me for a word of prayer. Lord, we love you. We thank you for this day. We thank you for Jesus, and we pray that as we're here, our eyes would be set to him, that our hearts would be filled with your Holy Spirit, that, Lord, we would be challenged and changed by the Word of God. Be with us today as only you can. Make this a special experience for each and every person who is here on this day, and we pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Good morning. I'm here to talk about the Muskogee Pregnancy Center. I was looking for my photo and that I thought I took. Aha, there it is. You know how you lose things. It's been around for a really long time, and I'd like to thank Grandview Baptist for the support that you guys have given. Over the years, I've been on the board, I don't remember, 6 or 8 months or so. Lori is our treasurer and has worked tirelessly for many, many years in that capacity. There have been times, I know many of you know Vicky Pack, who passed away, and she was the director. And so there are times that it's gone through some struggles about, you know, what is our purpose, what, you know, but God seemed to keep either bringing in new financial means or different things. And so we really feel like that, you know, God is wanting us to move forward. One thing that we've started doing, Save the Storks, which is an organization out of Broken Arrow, has been, one of the ladies has been coming down monthly to do ultrasounds. She's been twice. They are free to anybody you can call and schedule and make an appointment, or you can walk in. The first day, we did it in, I think it was December. Anyway, it was, we had 9 women that came in. One of them had no medical attention, and she was about a month from delivering. There's so many needs out there. And we still do free pregnancy tests, but I don't think that is quite as important as some of the other outreach and this ultrasound, them coming in once a month. I mean, ultimately, we would love to have the ability to do it at the center. If you're not familiar, the center has moved to 2421 South York, Suite 15. So when you turn on to South York Street, you know, the big, we have a sign up now. I can't think. the store locations there where there's like Subway on the left, right before you get to Hancock. It's in that row of buildings. There's been a lot that's happened. It was a Christian that owned it, but now that is sold. So, I mean, they made it the rent. So there's several things you can be praying about. You can pray about, you know, we have our location at least for almost a year. You know, hopefully we don't have to move. Hopefully we can afford to stay right there because it's working pretty well. The ultrasounds, that we can continue to do that. But eventually it would be nice to be able to do them at our location. And we have an ultrasound machine and it's at Dr. McIntosh's office, but it's very, very old. There is some grant money that we could apply for, but we have to have someone that can do that. We do have an RN that's currently a volunteer and that is looking at possibly taking some training, which they can provide, and we can even have scholarships to pay for that. But we definitely need someone that's at that location that we could do this, offer it more often. Right now it's just once a month. It will be, the next one will be January 27th, which would be, I guess, this Friday from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. It's on Facebook. If you're my friend or if you're in What's Going On in Muskogee, you can go and you can maybe share the page. If you know someone that would like to, you know, have an ultrasound, reach out to them. Many of these women, we hope, will come back for an Earn While You Learn program where they can earn, like, points to get, like, diapers or baby things that we have there, and they learn about parenting and about, you know, just the overall process. So it's a great outreach. So it appears that maybe our focus is looking toward trying to support women and, you know, hopefully being able to talk to them. But when these women, we see that baby in the ultrasound, it does make them, you know, want to choose life for their baby. We also have a need for volunteers. If anyone is interested and would like to donate, you know, work 4 hours or so a week. Right now we can only be open on Thursdays. We're down on volunteers. When the Pregnancy Center first started back, I think it was late 80s, early 90s, I mean, I was actually a volunteer at that time. And it's a very rewarding experience, but we need more volunteers. Since Vicki passed away, we're in need of a director, and I think there is an application, I was told, that maybe was going out for someone that may be interested. So there's a lot of things to pray for. You know, your financial support has been just wonderful. Grandview is one of the ones that is every month we count on, and we know that's dependable. Revenues of support, but there's need for volunteers. There's a need for prayer for all of these multitude of things, and not only that, but the women that come in, and more volunteers. So there's a lot of things that you can do, and if you're interested, you can see me, you can see Lori, and we can get you set up to do that. So.
Before we continue,
join me in prayer. Father, we come before you at this time, and Lord, we are thankful for this ministry. In the time that we're in, there are so many women that are hurting, so many women that have questions, so many women that need help. And I thank you, Lord, for this ministry that is available. I pray that in the coming days that you would increase the capability of what they can do, that you would provide workers. Would provide, Lord, a new director, and that, Lord, we would see some of the best days ahead. We here at Grandview, we believe in life, and we support life, and we thank you, Lord, for so many of the lives that have been changed and so many of the young lives that have been impacted as a result of this. So we pray your blessing on this, and for the best in the future, we ask this now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Time again, my life was in His hands. 1 John 3:1, see how great a love the Father has bestowed on us that we should be called children of God.
Pray with me. Father, we thank you for this wonderful day. We thank you that that we can be in your house to give you all the praise and the worship. We pray that we will do so in a way that will glorify you and your kingdom. God, we just pray that we'll be able to discern our wants from our needs. God, we need Jesus. We need that forgiveness and salvation from our sins. And God, we just that we pray that we won't take going to church for granted, that we thank you for the classes that we have to go to. We thank you that that you can better equip us for being disciples through your word. And God, we just thank you so much that we just pray, God, for this, just for your return. We pray that you will be with those who are having the many surgeries this week. We pray that you will remove the disease and the heartache from our world. God, we just thank you so much that we thank you for our freedom that we have to serve and to worship you in our country. And we pray that we will not be denied in praising your name. God, just be with us with this week and just give us the love that we need to go out in the world to share the world with Jesus. And it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Morning.
Glad that you were able to make it on this day, and I'm glad we didn't have snow. You know, for a preacher, the worst time to have snow is on the weekend. Let us know during the week. Everybody is happy. The kids are happy. They don't have to go to school if it's bad enough, and then it'll melt by the weekend. That's what I always pray for. So anyway, hey, we're glad that you are here, this is a special day for me. Back in the 1980s, I was approached by a pro-life group to go and speak when I was in college throughout the state of Arkansas. We would show a film that was put together by Bernard Nathanson, who was the director at one time of the National Abortion Rights Action League, called Silent Scream, that vividly illustrated what happened in the womb of a woman when a child was aborted. And we would go through the state, and our hope was that we would be able to speak to the hearts and lives of people and convince them on the importance of life in the womb. And so for many years I did that when I was in school, and then I've always recognized this day. This is an important day. It says what we stand for. We stand for life, both in the womb and outside of the womb. Amen? And I've always tried to have something ready to speak on regarding this subject on this very important day, even with the change that occurred with our Supreme Court. And so a couple of years ago when I was at Pickles Gap, the first time I preached on this, someone said, "I've never heard anybody preach that on this day." And I thought, my goodness, what are we doing? This is something that all of us should be aware of, and we should certainly be prayerful on a day like this, because it's just too important. And so as we speak on this subject, you know, there are a lot of people who say, well, what is the connection between what people like you say when you talk about the sanctity of human life and being pro-life? What is the connection between that and Scripture? And there's a lot in Scripture that speaks on that. And I'd like to take you on a journey through the book of 2 Kings with me. So if you will, take your Bible and turn with me to the book of 2 Kings. And I want you to look with me, beginning in verse 1, chapter 21, beginning in verse 1, and we see a character by the name of Manasseh who became king when he was just 12 years old. So it says in verse 1, if you're all there, say amen. Some of you are saying amen while you're turning pages. Come on, we're in the house of the Lord, right? 2 Kings chapter 21, beginning in verse 1, the Bible says Manasseh was 12 years old when he became king. How would you like to have a king that was 12 years old? How many of you that are 12 years old would love to be king? I know I would have loved it at that point, but probably would have been as big a success as him. He was 12 years old when he became king, and he reigned 55 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Hephzibah. What a name. And he did evil in the sight of the Lord. You see a lot of this in the book of 2 Kings with kings. He did evil in the sight of the Lord according to the abominations of the nations whom the Lord had cast out before the children of Israel. For he rebuilt the high places which Hezekiah, his father, had destroyed. He raised up altars for Baal and made a wooden image as Ahab, king of Israel, had done. And he worshipped all the host of heaven, and he served them. He also built altars in the house of the Lord, of which the Lord had said, "In Jerusalem I will put my name." And he built altars for all the host of heaven in the two courts of the house of the Lord. And he made his sons pass through the fire. In other words, put them to death. He killed them. He made them pass through the fire, practiced soothsaying, used witchcraft, and consulted spiritists and mediums. I'd like to camp on that, but that's not what I'm going to talk about this morning. He did much evil in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger. And he even set a carved image of Asherah that he had made in the house which the Lord had said to David and to Solomon his son, "In this house and in Jerusalem, which I have chosen out of all the tribes of Israel, I will put my name forever." And I will not make the feet of Israel wander anymore from the land which I gave their fathers, only if they are careful to do according to all that I have commanded them and according to all the law that my servant Moses commanded them. But they paid no attention, and Manasseh seduced them to do more evil than the nations whom the Lord had destroyed before the children of Israel. 2,600 years ago, wicked King Manasseh, even at 12 years old, he started off wrong. But wicked King Manasseh betrayed his religious heritage in the nation of Judah by sacrificing his sons to the pagan god Molech. Judah, the nation that was once righteous, once God-fearing, offered no outcry, no remorse, no repentance, and many followed Manasseh's bad example. What is God's response? Look in the verses that follow. It says, and the Lord God spoke to him by his servants, the prophets, saying, because Manasseh, the king of Judah, has done these abominations, he has acted more wickedly than all the Amorites which were before him. And he's also made Judah sin with his idols. Therefore, thus says the Lord God of Israel, behold, I am bringing such calamity upon Jerusalem and Judah, and whoever hears of it, both his ears will tingle. And I will stretch over Jerusalem the measuring line of Samaria and the plummet of the house of Ahab, and I will wipe Jerusalem as one wipes a dish, wiping it and turning it upside down. So I will forsake the remnant into the hand of their enemies, and they shall become victims of plunder to all their enemies, because they have done evil in my sight and have provoked me to anger since the day their fathers came out of Egypt, even to this day. Moreover, Manasseh shed very much innocent blood till he had filled Jerusalem from one end to the other, besides his sin by which he made Judah sin in doing evil in the sight of the Lord. It is true in our day that just in this last year, the Supreme Court struck down the Roe versus Wade decision, leaving that decision in the future in the hands of our states. And abortion has been made illegal, yes, in Oklahoma, still legal in many other states in our union, but there are still pro-life issues that we must address. I believe, and I am convinced, that life begins at conception. Can we agree on that? In fact, we find that God formed us from the very beginning, and even still in the state of Oklahoma, the day after pill is still available, and so we still have a problem with abortion in our state. I'm glad for where we are. Don't get me wrong. Many lives have been saved. Thousands in this last year, in these last several months, have been saved in our state, and yet we must still remain strong in this area. So in light of this Sanctity of Human Life Sunday, I want us to consider a few things that certainly may speak to our hearts as to why we believe what we believe. First of all, the first thing that I want you to remember this morning is that Scripture views an unborn child as a person. That is without a doubt. Throughout the pages from the beginning of the book of Genesis all the way to the very end, we find that the Bible regards life as life even in the womb. Take your Bibles, if you will, and turn with me to the 119th or 139th Psalm real quickly. It's not too far from where we are in the book of 2 Kings. And there in the 139th Psalm, we find that the Word of God says this, beginning in verse 13. Listen to this. For you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. My frame was not hidden from you, even while he's in his mother's womb. When I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth, your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed. This is the prenatal development that occurs with any person who is born. and you saw me though I was yet unformed, and in your book they all were written, the days fashioned for me when as yet there were none of them. To David, as he writes this psalm, life began in the room, in the womb, and it is something that we should regard as being the case. I mean, listen, there's no reason for me to even continue to preach or to speak on this subject this morning because of that very verse. If that was all there was in Scripture to speak about the pro-life issue, listen, that would be enough, but that's not all we find in Scripture, is it? In fact, just this week in our reading that I do on Facebook, Monday through Friday, in the 119th Psalm, it says this in verse 73, your hands, this is the Lord, your hands made me, Scripture says, and your hands formed me. And it is the case for all of us. As we were conceived, we were placed in the womb of our mothers, and in our mother's womb, the hand of God, the sovereign hand of God, He formed us and made us into who we are. Katrina, he did a real good job with me, didn't he? Amen. I'm so glad. We're not talking about mere fetal tissue. Mere fetal tissue cannot possess a moral nature, as we read about in the 139th Psalm and as we read in other portions of Scripture. As David says in Psalm 51 and verse 5, behold, I was brought forth in iniquity. He says, I was brought forth as a sinner, and in sin my mother conceived me. You can't say that about mere tissue. And David is speaking about moral issues. When I was born and as I was formed in the womb of my mother, he says, I was formed in iniquity. As we read about the birth of Jesus, we see that there's much said about unborn life, even in our Lord's development as he was brought into this earth. In Matthew chapter 1, it speaks a lot about it, and we see a lot that is said about his birth there in Matthew chapter 1. And beginning in verse 18, it tells us what happened in his life. It says the birth of Jesus, Matthew 1 and verse 18, the birth of Jesus was as follows. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Moving forward a little bit in verse 22, it says, so all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, the child who is formed. Emmanuel, which is translated, and this is literally what the word Emmanuel means, God with us. And do you remember that first time that Elizabeth, the cousin of Mary, met her cousin Mary, and Elizabeth, older in age, also had a child, and in her womb was the child that we would know as John the Baptist. Do you remember what happened? As they met together, Elizabeth said this in Luke chapter 1 and verse 44, for indeed, as soon as the voice of your greeting sounded in my ears, the babe in my womb leaped for joy. Amen. Leap for joy. Now you see this. Do you realize this? Do you know this? That a fetus, a child in the womb, was the first to rejoice at the news of Jesus. When Mary meets Elizabeth, John gets so excited about it while he's still in his mother's womb that he begins to leap for joy. How can you not but help leap for joy knowing who Jesus is? And this is what happened in that particular day. Scripture, without a doubt, views the unborn child as a person. Can I get an amen on that this morning? Scripture also has a high requirement for those who are in authority. For those who served in authority in Israel, and even those of us who are under authority in our country, Scripture requires all of those who are in authority to protect the innocent and the defenseless. In fact, I would say that's the most important thing that they do. Protect the innocent and the defenseless. And as we go back and we look at the founding of Israel as a nation, we find that the Lord God Himself instituted civil laws forbidding murder and demanding penalties for those who are violators. One of the Ten Commandments says this, you know it, Exodus chapter 20, Beginning in verse 13, it says, "You shall not murder." Many of us learned it as "thou shalt not kill," but the word to use there is actually murder. You shall not murder. This is one of the basic foundational moral laws that should be regarded everywhere. You shall not murder. We know murder is wrong, and we are repulsed by the thought of murder when one kills another for no reason at all. It is mystifying and horrifying. Many of you this week were as stunned as I was when they found the lifeless body of the poor little four-year-old girl that had been missing for some time, and horrified at the story in the news of such a thing happening to such a poor little innocent girl. And we certainly want to see justice regarding that as well. Amen. And we find in Leviticus, the Lord God said this to the children of Israel regarding murder. Leviticus 24 and verse 17 says this: "Whoever kills a man shall be put to death." It's very simple, basic, foundational principle that is in Scripture. Some people say, "Well, I don't support, I don't support capital punishment." Well, that's your opinion, but it flies in the face of what Scripture says. When one is guilty and they murder, in the Old Testament system, and according to Old Testament law, the theocratic law that was established in Israel, when a person takes a life, their life shall be taken from them. And so this is foundational. This is something that was at the beginning in Israel's history. As we move on, for instance, in Deuteronomy chapter 24, and I'm not going to ask you to turn there, but in verses 17 through 21, I'm not even going to read it this morning. It teaches us this, that God orders protection for the innocent and the helpless. Who is more innocent and helpless than the child that is in a womb? Who needs more protection? Who needs protection more than the child that exists in the womb of our precious mothers today? There is much that is said about that as we go on, as God establishes his covenant with Noah. One of the things that we find is that he prohibited, even before the Mosaic Law was established, he prohibited the shedding of innocent blood. In Genesis 9 and verse 6, the Lord God said this to Noah: "Whoever sheds man's blood by man, his blood shall be shed. In the image of God he made man." And so we get to the focus of why life is so important. Listen, we are not a human animal. I don't care what anybody says. I don't care what they try to propose on PBS or any of the other science channels. Amen. We are not an animal. We are unique and set apart from the animal kingdom. Now, this does not mean that I don't love animals. My wife can tell you this morning that I have a little 11, 12-year-old wiener dog that just about rules my life. And I love animals, and we are given a responsibility to care for animals, but that wiener dog is not the same as you or me. You see, we are given a soul. And the Bible says, as we are created, we find that even initially, very early in the book of Genesis, that we are created in the image of God. We are image bearers of Him. That sets us apart, and that's what makes human life much more valuable. And so because of that, life is valuable. Unborn life is valuable. Life after birth is valuable. And by the way, I want to tell you, listen, I think one of the big mistakes that we have made in the pro-life movement is that we are focused a lot on the sanctity of life in the womb. Amen. I think we can all agree on that. But I'll tell you, listen, there is sanctity of life after birth. And we are in a crisis today with children who need homes, children who need people to look after them, children who need care, children who need guidance. We don't want people locked away in the system. I'll tell you, bless God, it would be great if we saw a revival among Christians in caring for children. I really believe that. Katrina and I have done that in the past, and we believe in that. And so the reason we believe in that is because life is precious. We are made in the image of God. People are worth it. Amen. Can I get an amen on that? People are worth it. And we should love people, all people. People that come from difficult circumstances. People that come from circumstances that maybe doesn't matter who you are, what your name is, what color of skin that you have. The Lord has a place for you. And we find that early on, even as God speaks to Noah in the book of Leviticus. We find this. Turn with me in Leviticus chapter 20. That's back over in your Old Testament. in an area where all your pages are stuck together in your Bible. That's a joke, folks. Leviticus 20. Leviticus 20, I want you to look with me there, beginning in verse 22. In Leviticus 20, beginning in verse 22, we find that the Word of God teaches this. Look with me. It says, "You shall therefore keep all my statutes and all my judgments and perform them, that the land where I am bringing you to dwell may not vomit you out. And you shall not walk in the statutes of the nation which I am casting out before you. They committed all these things, and therefore I abhor you." And so earlier in the book of Leviticus, one of the things that God is saying through Moses is he is warning them about the problems that existed with the child sacrifices that were going on at that time. And he promises to destroy a nation that allows this kind of abomination to occur. And yet, over and over and over again, as we read through the book of Amos, or through the Old Testament, and even in the book of Amos, which I'm going to quote to you here in just a minute, and then throughout history, we find that it is almost as if we ignore that. It's almost as if we say, God will certainly allow that. I'm the exception. Our nation is the exception to this particular prohibition. And certainly, we can get away with it, but I don't know if anybody else can. In Amos chapter 1 and verse 13, we find that the Ammonites, this is not a nation as Israel. You know, some people say that these laws only applied to Israel or to Judah, and yet in Amos chapter 1 and verse 13, Amos points out that the Ammonites were judged by God because they ripped open the pregnant women of Gilead. And so God even sees this as a problem in nations not founded by Moses. And they were judged by God, the Ammonites were, for such a thing. Later on, God indicts the Babylonians because their city was built on bloodshed. In Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 12, it says this, "Woe to him who builds a town with bloodshed, who establishes a city by iniquity." And so God has consistently, and this is why this is so important to us today, God has consistently judged peoples who defy his laws regarding the protection of innocent life. And it is something that we should take serious in our country. I'm worried that over the last 30 or 40 years, since Roe v. Wade has been established, God has not turned a blind eye to our nation and what has happened. Thomas Jefferson said years ago, the third president of the United States, who basically wrote the Declaration of Independence, he said, "The duty of government is to defend the defenseless and to protect the innocent." Can we agree with that today? I think he was on to something. And yet after Roe versus Wade was passed by the Supreme Court in 1973, over 60 million innocent and defenseless children had been slaughtered in this country. Worldwide, between 2010 and 2014, the World Health Organization estimated that an average of 50 million abortions were performed per year worldwide. This is not just a problem in America, it is a problem worldwide. In 2016, heart disease and stroke killed 15.2 million. And yet, as you look at the numbers, even with a drop in abortion in America, we can confidently say, even today, that abortion is the number one cause of death in the world today. That's sobering. It also tells me that we may be very well on the verge of the return of Jesus Christ to set things right. It is a worldwide problem. It is not just an American problem. It is not just a problem in Europe. It is not just a problem in Africa. It is not a problem in South America. It is a problem that God sees, and the blood of millions upon millions of people cry out to the heavens today. Now, I know what I say this morning as I speak on this subject is not popular. My biblically based opinion, however, listen, right? Amen? I want to tell you, listen, I may have people think that I'm wrong, and I've always kind of said this, I may be wrong, but I'm never in doubt, and I'm definitely not in doubt when it comes to what the Word of God has to say on this subject. According to what we see in our polls today, my biblically based decision is not popular. A Gallup poll today tells us that 6 in 10 Americans now believe and support abortion. Think about that. That's where we are today. We have an endless barrage of information that is out there. In fact, if you were to watch CNN, MSNBC, ABC, CBS, NBC, any of those stations, you would find that I am a villain and an outlaw for speaking as I do today. Call me whatever you want. Label me any way you desire. I'd fall in line with the prophets of the Old Testament and the disciples of the New Testament. The world didn't like what they had to say as well. How can we say, in light of all that has gone on, and you've seen the images, you know what's going on, how can we say, with all the child slaughter worldwide that has gone on, how can we say that it has gone unnoticed by God? It hasn't. I do not know when the worldwide door is going to swing back the other way, but it will. It will. What is that going to mean? Could it be that some of the disease that we see that has been on the run could be as a result of God's judgment? I don't know. Could it be that there's some future calamity headed the world's way? Certainly we can say that, especially if you read the book of Revelation. Listen, the door is opening and the time is coming where God will judge the world. Now, listen, those of us who love the Lord, I believe the Bible teaches that there's a rapture that is coming and we would be delivered out of that. I think that's what the Bible teaches. But I do believe that judgment is coming. So here's the question. We may not accept it. We may not believe it. What can we do? Well, the story that we find in the book of 2 Kings, it has hope. The story of Manasseh has hope. As a matter of fact, did you know that he eventually repented? Manasseh, wicked King Manasseh, that led that nation into great wickedness, he repented. And his grandson, Josiah, was a king that was loved by God. And as he stepped into office and he took the throne, he instituted repentance and reforms and brought the nation back to God. Could it be in this last breath before the return of the Lord that we are at the beginning of one last great awakening in our country? I pray that that is the case. That's why I preach every Sunday. I want to see revival break out in this land unlike it has ever been seen in our nation's history. Could it be that we are on the verge of that today? It is possible. But we also know this. God still judged Judah. Yet for 30 years, there was an opportunity for repentance. For 30 years, there was an opportunity for hope. And because of Josiah's example, future generations were affected. Who knew about Josiah? How about Daniel, for one? Daniel knew about Josiah, and he said, that's the way that I want to live. And so as he's carried off captive into Babylon, he stands up for what is right, and he says, I will not compromise. No matter how hard it is, I will not back down. I will be a child of God. And in the face of adversity, he said, I'm going to be what God created me to be, a child of God who loves him and who lives for him. So he wouldn't bend his knee, he wouldn't bow, he wouldn't break, even when he was an old man and thrown into a deep dungeon with a den of hungry lions. He came out alive because he believed. And then his friends Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you know their story. They were in league. They were in league with Daniel as well. And they wouldn't bow and worship the false idol. And they were thrown into the heart of a fiery furnace. Because they wouldn't compromise. But they lived, didn't they? They lived. And the Lord was there to deliver them. And then there's Ezekiel, who was there at that same time. And he continued to proclaim the word of the Lord and shared the truth with God's people as he was there, captive in Babylon as well. And it was all because of Josiah's example. We can set an example today, can we not? And we can pray for leaders who set a godly example. But what can we do? Let me give you four quick things that we can do, and this is where we'll close. The first thing that we can do, number one, is to repent. You say, well, what do I have to repent of?
We should repent, I believe, for being apathetic to pro-life causes before and even causes before and after birth. We should commit ourselves to loving and protecting the most innocent and defenseless among us in our country today. Children are being taken advantage of at an alarming rate in our country today. And there's story after story that I can tell you. I don't have time to do it, but we should be aware of that. Number two, we should forgive. We should forgive. Some have been hurt by this issue, and it's time to forgive them. There are some who attend our churches who have had an abortion or they've had abortions. And I want to tell you, listen, if God forgives, we can forgive. Amen? We should forgive them. And there are some who are here, maybe you've had an abortion, and maybe you haven't forgiven yourself as of yet. It's time to forgive yourself. It's time to forgive yourself as God forgives you. Thirdly, we can pray. We can pray. We can pray that abortion would end worldwide and that God would transform hearts and lives in our state, in our nation, and in our world. I believe that's very important. As a matter of fact, one of the great verses that we read is found in the book of 2 Chronicles, that is a sister book to the books of 1 and 2 Kings. And in 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14, it says this, "If my people," this is on us, folks, "if my people who are called by my name," this is not everybody else, this is you and I, "if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land." We say today, why won't God bless America as we were once blessed? Go back to 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14. My people, God's people, should pray, right? We should forsake our evil ways. We should pray that God would heal this land. And prayer does a lot. You know, some people say, well, prayer is the least I can do. I disagree with that. Prayer, ladies and gentlemen, today is the most that we can do. And we should pray for our nation and pray for those hearts that have turned from God and pray for our leaders and pray for those who are in authority and pray for our physicians, our doctors, our healthcare workers. Pray for our young people that are in our world today. And pray that God would heal this land. And here's the fourth thing that we can do. We can act. Lynn talked about ways that we can act to support our pregnancy resource center. That's very important. But we should act. And there are things that we can do. Not everybody can volunteer, but there are some things that we can do and should do as far as act. And it begins, I believe, with loving on people. You know, there are some people and some young women in churches that have been ostracized because they had an abortion or people found out about it. That's a shame. That's a shame. We should love on people. Amen? I want to tell you, listen, anybody that ever thinks that the church is a place full of perfect people, they have misjudged what the church is. The church is full of people that have made all kinds of mistakes. We've screwed up left and right at times in our life. The church is full, it's a spiritual hospital for people who need healing by God. Amen. Is anybody here, have you lived a perfect life? Listen to me. The same grace that is extended toward you, we should extend towards others as well. Amen. And that being said, listen, I want to tell you, there are people who say, well, I'm looking for the perfect church. Well, if you find the perfect church, you better run from it because you won't fit in. We should love on people. Some young women have been ostracized because they chose to carry a child to full term. Shame on us. Young women make mistakes. We know that. And pregnancies occur sometimes. Years ago, when I was a younger pastor, we had one of our young women that was either a teenager or just barely a little bit above it. And she found herself pregnant. And I had people come to me and ask me, what do we do? I said, well, the first thing we're going to do is we're going to wrap our arms around her, and we're going to make her absolutely sure that this church loves her. And I said, secondly, we're going to call our ladies together, and we are going to have a baby shower for this precious girl. And when that baby is born, we're going to bring that baby into our nursery, and we're going to love on that baby. And not only that, but we're going to teach that baby the things of the Lord. So this child that has been brought into this earth, it's not only under perfect circumstances, but that's the case with most of us. And so we're going to love on that child. We're going to love on that mother. And I want to tell you today, that mother is married. That child is growing. Amen. And has a sister now. And they're growing, and her husband loves the Lord, and they're serving the Lord. And I think a big part of that is because we didn't look down our noses at that precious girl. We loved on her. Amen? And we can do that. That's one way that we can act. Shame on churches that point fingers at people that make mistakes. That's being a part of the solution, and that's something that we can absolutely do. Love on people who have made mistakes. Love on people who have had a pregnancy that didn't come in the best circumstance. And we can support crisis pregnancy centers. We can support the Pregnancy Resource Center here in town. We can encourage adoption. We can encourage foster parenting. And we can be an example to those who are around us who made mistakes. What I'm telling you is, though we live in a time that surely seems dark and it seems as if morals have been set aside, there's still time for us to make a difference. There's time for us to minister to people. There's time for us to have a positive impact in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to people who come with hurting hearts. You know, some people say, well, you know, I'm just not sure about that. We ought to be a little more hard on people that do that. Think about what Jesus did with the adulterous woman. All of the religious people were there, and they were ready to stone her. You know what I find is interesting in that story is it says they found this adulterous woman, and she was caught in the very act. And you know, the first thing that comes to my mind, Brother Jay, is where was the man? It's just the woman. It's just the woman that was being persecuted. And all the religious people were out there. They picked up their stones. They were ready to put her to death. And they asked Jesus what he thought, and he knelt down and he began to write on the ground. We don't know what he wrote. But he said this: he who is without sin, cast the first stone. And one by one, they dropped their rocks and they went their way. And the only two that were left standing was that poor woman who wouldn't even dare look up, and the Lord Jesus Christ. And he bent down to her, cupped her chin with his hand, had her look up, and he said, where are your accusers? They're not here. Go and sin no more. We need that kind of religion in our day. We don't need any of the Pharisaical stuff. We need a religion that says, we love you, we forgive you, we'll support you, no matter what has happened in your past. Today, our world has seen change. Our state has seen great change. And a lot of it has come as a result of prayers and the work of many of you who are in this room today. But our work is not finished. Life is still life. And life is valuable. All of it is precious. And we are made in the image of God. And we should love on people who are made in His image. We should stand up for life as we are called to do. And we can pray for change in this world. So what do we do about it? It begins in prayer. This morning during this invitation time, I'm going to ask for you to join me in a time of prayer. Christians, maybe you want to stay where you are. Maybe you want to come to the altar this morning. And you want to pray this morning for our our workers at our Pregnancy Resource Center. That's very, very important ministry that we're involved in, and I'm glad that we have a financial commitment to that. And maybe you're here today and you say, I want to pray for that. Maybe you're here and you'd like to talk to Lynn about volunteering your time. Maybe you can do that. Maybe you can help in that. I think Katrina's wanting to commit to doing something like that. And so if you're here and you'd like to do that, speak with Lynn. Lynn would be glad to speak with you about that, I'm sure. Or Lori, who's speaking at another church this morning on this very subject today. Speak with her and talk with her about that. It's all very, very important. Maybe you're here and maybe you've been affected negatively by this issue in the past. And today you realize the grace of God and what God's grace means, and that God is willing and ready to forgive you, and you just need to accept it today and be thankful for the Lord forgiving you. And maybe today you need to spend time in this altar just saying, Lord, I choose to forgive myself as you've forgiven me. Or maybe you have someone you know who is in your family who is struggling, who is suffering, that the Lord loves. You know, the Bible tells us God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And today there are all kinds of people who have made all kinds of mistakes that need to be reminded that Jesus died for their sin and he's willing to forgive them. He laid it all on the line for them, for me, for you. And maybe you know someone who needs the Lord and you want to pray for them today. They're struggling, they're hurting, they've made mistakes, and yet the Lord wants to save them and you want to pray for them. You know, God changes things when people pray. Or maybe you're here and you know that you need to be saved today. You know that you've never made a commitment to the Jesus who died for you. And today you'd be willing to step out and make that commitment to him. If that's you, this invitation is for you. So let's stand together, heads bowed, eyes closed. I'm going to lead us in a word of prayer. And following this prayer, this will be the time for you to come and time for you to respond. You do as the Lord leads. Lord, we come to you today, and we want to thank you today for the word of God, that it never returns void. And as we're here today and in this hour, I pray for people whom you've spoken to, people who need to make a public commitment, people who need to pray and lay their burdens out before you in this altar, people who are burdened for a family member or a friend or someone they know who is struggling, and they know that prayer can change things, or even a person who needs to be saved. God, according to your word, your will, and your way, I pray that you would open their heart by your Holy Spirit, that you would draw them so that they can be born again today. We ask all this now in Christ's holy name. Amen. Amen. And you come now as the Lord leads. As soon as we begin to sing, this is your time to do business with the Lord.
Just as I am.
I did the best I could. If you want anything better, you're going to have to find somebody else. How about that? Listen, we appreciate you. Thank you for your attentiveness. This is a very important subject to me, and I know to many of you, and it's something I'll be preaching for the rest of my life, no matter what happens. So anyway, we appreciate it. Be in prayer for all these things that we talked about. It's vitally important and something that we should continue to focus on. I also have one matter that I want to bring to your attention. When we were here for the Thanksgiving dinner Wednesday night, just a couple of months ago, someone had brought us like four plastic laundry baskets to help us move. I have those in my office. We finally emptied those. If those are your green laundry baskets, please let me know. Please let me know. And I've got them waiting for you. I'll carry them out to your car. I'll do whatever you want to with them. They're great. Okay. All right. We'll get them for you. All right. Very good. I couldn't remember, you know, back then everybody's face was, you know, I didn't know anything. So I know a little bit more today, but Greg, we'll get that to you. All right. Sounds good. Hey, listen, we love you. Let's close in prayer. And after we pray, we will be dismissed today. And I'd like to ask, where's Brother Rick? Brother Rick, are you back there? Have you prayed in a while? Okay, let's have Brother Rick close us in prayer.